Good morning. We are continuing our study of the book of Romans. Come to three, what I call introduction chapters, three and four. They introduce you to chapter five. There's a lot here, a lot of good doctrine. But it's really an introduction to the absolute beautiful explanation of salvation and how it works that takes place in chapter 5. So we're going to probably go through 3 and 4 this morning, and I'll try and start chapter 5 next week. We may spend a little extra time on chapter 5. But let's just start with a short one. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, we ask that you be with all of us. We know that you're holy and that your holiness and righteousness are consistent. And that there is no changing. We know that in Malachi, you tell Malachi that I am God and I change not. And we know that. And we thank you for it. We need consistency. And Lord, you give it to us. Lord, we ask that you be with me. My teachings will glorify your name, and we ask that everyone get a little bit out of this, and please, Lord, send the Holy Spirit as a teacher. We ask this in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Amen. If I seem to be dancing around today, or moving, or I wince, it's because I spent the last 2 days up on my 912 pitch roof putting up sheeting and paper. And every muscle in my body hurt. My toes hurt. It's not something I was looking forward to, but I think maybe 10 to 15 years of not having to shovel my roof is going to be worth it in the long run. So bear with me if I wince a little, or if I seem to lose my place. I don't want to do that either. But I'm in quite a bit of pain right now, so bear with me. We're going to start where we left off last week. Was at the end of chapter 2. And we're going to start into chapter 3 this week. 3 and 4, like I say, are kind of an introduction to chapter 5. Paul gets long-winded, I say, in chapter 3. He goes over some very important doctrinal facts, but he dwells on them for quite a while in order to express the importance of them. And because of his long sentences and his long-windedness in this, it's probably going to seem like we're going to blow through chapters 3 and 4 quickly. But really, there's just a very few very important high points in these two chapters that need to be gone over and need to be explained. But a lot of it is just repetition by Paul in trying to get the facts across to everyone. When he wrote this book to Rome, the book of Romans, he wrote it to the Romans. But as Romans, he was writing it to the entire world. So he wants to hit everyone. He wants to make sure everyone understands what he's saying. And so he goes over some of this in ways where it hits the Gentiles, the Romans, who are some Gentiles, and there are some Romans who are Jews. But he wanted to be sure everybody got hit. So he repeats a lot of this, but it makes he makes the point very, very clear. And those points, when we get to those, I will tell you, and it's probably a good idea to underline them because they're extremely important points. So what advantage then hath the Jew? Or what profit is there of circumcision? Much, every way, chiefly because that unto them were committed the oracles of God. We know that God spoke to the Jews, no people have the claim that God spoke to them. He gave them the laws. He hits hard on some things. And I want to touch on this idea of, and he hits it, but we hear the word used, circumcision, and being from a medical background, I just wanted to hit on the fact that one of the reasons that the Egyptians were so worried about the Jews was that they reproduced like flies. They just couldn't stop having babies, and that's why they were Pharaoh had the babies killed in Moses' time, the male babies killed. One of the reasons that the Jews reproduced the way they did was because of the law that God gave them. And one of those things was circumcision. An uncircumcised male can carry a lot of bacteria, a lot of infection. It causes sterility. It also causes stillborn babies. So some of these things were what the Jews with their circumcision were millennia beyond all other peoples in the world at that time, as far as cleanliness goes. And it made them so that they were so that their most of their babies lived. And one of the reasons was circumcision. It's something that's performed now almost without question, simply because of that fact that it's so much more, it's so much cleaner, it's so much of a better way to live, and it saves a lot of infection and a lot of problems down the road. So from a medical background, it always astounded me that almost 10,000 years ago, God gave Abraham a medical procedure that literally made it possible for the Jews to reproduce and to be able to flourish when other cultures were having problems with infertility and stillborn. So I just want to touch that because it's something that another sign of how far ahead God is of all of us. Nobody would have thought about that at the time. In fact, no man would have ever dreamed of doing that. But it was something that was medically necessary in order for the Jews to be able to reproduce at the rate that they did and to keep going. As many times as different cultures have tried to wipe out the Jews, they've never been able to. And one of the reasons is these millennia after millennia of just having a better percentage of babies living and being formed. So I'll get off my medical horse back to the Bible. For what if some did not believe? Shall their unbelief make the faith of God without effect? That's just like, I don't believe in taxes. But I pay them. I have to pay them, you know. Just because you don't believe in something doesn't make it not so. And that's what Paul is saying here is unbelief, does that make God any less God? No, it doesn't. God is God, no matter what. He says, God forbid, yea, let God be true, but every man a liar, as it is written. Thou mightest be justified in thy sayings, and mightest overcome when thou art judged. This is a quotation from Psalms, and as it is written, he's saying that every man, that God be true and every man a liar. And this is this is Paul starting to go into the idea of what we see in Malachi 13, I am God and I change you not. It says, God's judgments are righteous and pure and true, and they always will be. And no matter what man does or man says, it's not going to change the fact that God's judgments are pure.
Right.
So, but if our righteousness, commend the righteousness of God, what shall we say? Is God unrighteous? To take vengeance? I speak as a man. God forbid. For then how shall God judge the world? For if the truth of God hath more abound through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? So what Paul is getting across here is the fact that him being unrighteous, or his righteousness, either one, doesn't make God unrighteous. And again, he says, God forbid, for then how shall God judge the world? If God wasn't righteous, how could he judge the world? If he wasn't the pure truth, what would be the sense of him judging us? His judgments, again, like I say, are pure.
Right?
They're true. They're vengeful in that he is avenging our sin. And the fact that they are, and again, God says in Isaiah that vengeance is mine, saith the Lord. So, the fact, again, he's going over the same thing again. Like I said, he kind of just reiterates this same idea over and over in different words. But he is true, he's righteous, and he doesn't change. And that makes him very, very capable of judging us and being judged of us. And we cannot, it deems any argument we have moot, that anything we do or say can change that, or that anything that we do isn't to be judged by him. He states that we will judge us on every idle word we say.
Right.
It comes out of our mouths, and he will. And that makes him very, very capable of judging the world. And that's what Paul says in verse 6, God forbid, for then how shall God judge the world? If he's not righteous, he can't. It says, for if the truth of God hath more abounded through my lie unto his glory, why yet am I also judged as a sinner? And what Paul's saying here is that if he says anything, or he lies in order to magnify God or to glorify God, he's still going to be judged as a sinner. Even no matter what he has done, no matter how he tries to look before God, he's a sinner. Because he's going to make this point, he's going to drive this point home a little further out and down. But he goes over it again. He says, and not rather as we be slanderously reported, as some affirm that we say, let us do evil, that good may come. Whose damnation is just? God's damnation is just, is what he's saying here. And evil in the world can't cause any good. Any evil that happens, no matter what it is, the outcome is not going to be good. He says, what then? Are we better than they? No, in no wise. For we have before statement that he's trying to drive home here is verse 10. And as it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one. No matter what we try and do, no matter how we bend the truth, no matter how we try and glorify ourselves or glorify God, we're sinners.
Sure.
We were born with an innate sin quality. It came from Adam, and Adam's sin actually came from Lucifer. Lucifer was the first original sinner, but he sinned in heaven. Adam was the first sinner on earth. And we are all descendants of Adam. And so that sin is imputed to us through Adam. It says, there is none that understandeth. There is none that seeketh God. They are all gone out of the way. They are together become unprofitable. There is none that doeth good. No, not one. And he's going to drive this one home in the next few verses. But he wants to make it clear that no matter whether you're a Jew or a Gentile, you're in the guise of God, you're a sinner. That being a Jew doesn't make you any better in the eyes of God. And he's going to explain why further on in the chapter here. But Jews are sinners just as Gentiles. Jews have no hand up. They're God's chosen ones. And they know through the oracles of God what sin is. But it doesn't make them righteous. Sin is sin. And it's imputed to all mankind. It says, their throat is an open sepulchre. With their tongues they abuse deceit. The poison of asps is under their lips. His mouth is full of cursing and bitterness. Their feet are swift to shed blood. Destruction and misery are in their ways. And the ways of peace have they not known. There is no fear of God before their eyes. These are all quotations, mostly from Psalms. He's quoting the Bible here. So he's driving this part, this is driving it home to the Jews who are listening to this. He just quotes one quotation after another out of Psalms. And there's one here out of Isaiah, but most of it's out of Psalms. And he's just saying, he's just repeating what the Bible has said about man, what David has said in Psalms, and what other psalmists have said. Just repeating it over again. There's just no goodness in man at all. No matter what you do or how you look at it, man is innately wicked. It says, now we know that what things soever the law saith, it saith to them who are under the law. That every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God. And this is probably one of the most important statements, verse 20 in chapter 3. And it's something that he needs to drive home. And I'm sure at the time when Paul said this, and the Jews read it, they probably reeled back, because I'm sure a lot of them didn't understand that therefore by the deeds of the law there shall no flesh be justified in his sight. For by the law is the knowledge of sin. The commandments don't make people righteous. They merely reveal the fact that they're sinful people and they need God. They need the righteousness of God. When without God and without God's commandments. You go through life not even knowing your sin. So the heads up that the Jews have is that they have the law. They don't have an excuse because they have the law. And it was given to them by God. But that law doesn't make them righteous people. It just proves that no man can follow the law. No man can be righteous in the sight of God. God gave the Ten Commandments to Moses not to make the Jews righteous, but to prove to the Jews that they needed God. It says, but now the righteousness of God without the law is manifested, being witnessed by the law and the prophets. Even the righteousness of God, which is by faith of Jesus Christ, unto all and upon all them that believe. For there is no difference. For we all have sinned and come short of the glory of God. And again, here he's making it clear that Gentiles and Jews both have sinned and come short of the glory of God. But with the righteousness of Jesus Christ, by faith in Jesus Christ, our righteousness, the righteousness of Christ is given to us, and we're judged through Christ, not as the people we are. I always use the illustration that what Christ is a lens through whom God sees us. And that lens filters out our sin. You can't do it without our asking for it. We have to confess that sin. We have to repent of that sin. But once we do, when we stand before God in judgment, those who don't have Jesus Christ are going to be judged for their sin and for every word. Those who have Jesus, who have accepted Jesus Christ into their hearts, and who believe in his resurrection, believe that he's the Son of God. And if we confess our sins and repent of them, God's going to look at us through that lens, and he's not going to see any sin at all. And God's going to say, you're fine. I don't see any sin in you at all. But it's going to be for those sins that are confessed and repented. Any sins that we don't repent of or that we haven't confessed, we're still going to have to answer for those. But because of the righteousness of Jesus, they can be wiped away. For all have sinned and come short of the glory of God, being justified freely by his grace through the redemption that is Christ Jesus. And that's just what I want to say. It says, whom God has set forth to be a propitiation through faith in his blood, to declare his righteousness for the remission of sins that are past through the forbearance of God. The word propitiation, the root word there is property or to own. And Jesus owns our sin. When we confess it, when we repent through faith in Jesus Christ, our sin becomes his sin. righteous before God, that sin's gone away. So we no longer have to live with that sin. It's taken away from us. We no longer own it. He does. It says, to declare, I say, at this time, his righteousness, that he might be just and the justifier of him which believeth in Jesus. Where is boasting now? Is it exalted? By what law? Of works? Nay, but the law of faith. And he hits the Jew again here. Jews always boast about being God's chosen people, about having the law, about being better than everyone else. And what he's saying here is, where it is boasting? It's excluded. By what? The law of works? No. By the law of faith. They had no right to boast. Because a Gentile who has faith in Jesus Christ, in the eyes of God, is just as righteous as any Jew. Therefore, we conclude that a man is justified by faith without the deeds of the law. Is he the God of the Jews only? Is he not also of the Gentiles? Yes, of the Gentiles also. Seeing it is one God which shall justify the circumcision by faith and the uncircumcision through faith. Do we then make void the law through faith? God forbid. We establish the law. And he's going to go in chapter 4. He's going to explain the reason why faith is what's important. And this is what he's going to try and drive home, is that faith is the most important thing. Faith in Jesus. Not belief in the law. Because no one can live perfectly under the law. Everyone has lied sometime in their life.
Right.
Everyone has coveted someone else's possession sometime in their life. And to break one law is the same as breaking all. One's as bad as the other. These laws are given to the Jew. Again, not to make the Jew a better person, but to prove to the Jew that they need God to be a better person. That without God, they're just the same as anyone else. Any barbarian or any other person living on earth. Says, what shall we say to them? That Abraham, our father, as pertaining to the flesh, had found? For if Abraham were justified by works, he hath whereof to glory, but not before God. But what saith Scripture? Abraham believed God, and it was counted to him for righteousness. Now to him that worketh is the reward not reckoned. Grace, but death. So, if it was works, then wouldn't we owe debt to God for the works? But it's by faith. It's free. It's by grace through faith. And it's free. We can't buy it. We can't sell it. It can't be purchased. It can only be purchased by Jesus Christ. And we can only get it through faith in Jesus Christ. And it's a free gift. But to him that worketh not, but believeth on him that justifieth the ungodly, his faith is counted for righteousness. Even as David also described the blessedness of the man unto whom God imputed righteousness without works, saying, blessed are they whose iniquities are forgiven and whose sins are covered. Blessed is the man to whom the Lord will not impute sin. Cometh this blessing then upon the circumcision only, or upon the uncircumcision also? For we say that faith was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How is it then reckoned? When he was in circumcision or uncircumcision? What Paul's asking here is, was Abraham circumcised, then counted righteous? Did God make him righteous by after circumcision or because of circumcision? No. It had nothing to do with circumcision. It had to do with faith. Faith in God. Belief in God. It was the faith that was reckoned to Abraham for righteousness. How was it then reckoned? When he was in circumcision or uncircumcision? And he received the sign of circumcision as a seal of the righteousness of the faith, which he had yet been uncircumcised, that he might be the father of all them that believe. Though they be not circumcised, that righteousness might be imputed unto them also. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision only, but who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. Righteousness that was imputed to Abraham was by faith. By belief in God. He left his home. He left his family. He left everyone. He left everything. Because God told him. And because of that belief, that he was going to be made the father of a nation, a great nation, he did what God told him. As a sign that he was a special person, a person of great importance to God. God gave him the sign of circumcision. And the father of circumcision to them who are not of the circumcision, who also walk in the steps of that faith of our father Abraham, which he had being yet uncircumcised. For the promise that he should be the heir of the world was not to Abraham or to his seed through the law, but through the righteousness of faith. Paul's driving home this fact that it's faith, not the law, that leads to a more righteous life. That no matter what the law says, it's not going to make you any better. Faith in God, faith in Jesus Christ, is what is the key. And the Jews, at every point, and they used their religion as almost as a club to beat everyone else down with. And it was their boasting of having the law, having Levitical law, of all the ritual that they went through. And they got wrapped up in that ritual and that law and lost sight of faith. That's why Jesus was sent to earth, was to get the Jews off away from this idea of religion and ritual, and to get them back to faith in God. And in the process, open up that same faith to everyone on earth, Jew and Gentile. And that was the reason Jesus, the basic reason Jesus was sent. Paul's trying to drive this home right now. Is you Jews don't have any special possession of any kind of righteousness. What you have is the law that shows you that you're an unrighteous people. And now that Jesus, the Messiah, has come, you need him to get this righteousness. You need faith in Jesus now, because he is the Messiah. And God sent him to get you back to faith in God. Let's close. Dear Lord, our Heavenly Father, thank you for this time together. I hope that this lesson has gotten quite across that you are trying to drive that religion came.